Hi, everybody. I just wanted to give our next speaker a little bit of an introduction. It's my privilege to introduce Ramel Rones, who I know as Rami. Rami is a scientific consultant of mind-body therapies at Dana-Farber, Harvard Medical School Children's Hospital and Tufts Medical Center, as well as co-author of numerous scientific publications. He's also co-founder of the cancer complementary website, Cancer Wellness TV, which I've looked at and is really great. Rami lectures and instructs on techniques of the Eastern internal arts in hospitals, institutions, and schools around the world. And for those of you who are at Dana-Farber, he also runs several programs here. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Rami.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Hi.
Hi.
So I will first introduce you to a little bit of a PowerPoint, a few slides, just to explain about the Tai Chi. But usually before I start, I like to challenge participants with two tasks. One is try to keep your spine straight when you sit. So it's amazing how, if you look around, most people sit like that, you know. So I say there's three methods to reverse this. And you have to understand that when you sit like this, you only utilize a third of your lungs. When you sit like this, you compress the organs. When you sit like this, you compress the vertebrates. So lack of oxygen, circulation, digestive systems are crouched. So it's all about creating space. It's not just about a nice posture. It's also about creating space for the internal organs to function in the best way possible. So it's interesting how in the West we say I'm strong and we point to the biceps. Mm-hmm. And in the East people say I'm strong and they point to here. Mm-hmm. How many people die of failure of the biceps? Not many. So most of the problem are in the internal organs. So strength should be really measured in your internal organs. And if you want to know, that's part of the sign of the Buddha, is that he is abundant energy in the organ area, mm-hmm. and it symbolizes health. It doesn't symbolize food, eating. One Buddha does symbolize the food and eating. It's called Happy Buddha. But the other ones, it's all about abundant energy in the organs and vitality through the organs. So when I say sit straight, there's two tricks. One is, of course, to be independent. So you move away from the back of the seat and you try to sit independently with your spine straight. It's harder, it will take a few months, but then you'll strengthen the muscles between the pelvis and the ribs, and you'll be able to just sit like this. I remember in the 80s and the mid 80s, when you look around, it was even worse because now there's more awareness of posture, and every now and then you see someone sit straight, and right now you know, oh, that's a dancer. So dancers always would carry themselves that way, and over time and knowledge, more and more people are aware of it. So the second trick, which is a little easier, you move all the way to the back of the chair and you use the back of the chair like support. Okay, so that's the second trick. And the third trick is a little more obnoxious in certain areas, but you can go like this. So this is, all those three are better than this. That's the worst one, okay? So you try as much as you can. I'm not going to tell you I'm sitting like this all day, everywhere I go. I try to do the best I can. That's the bottom line. I say if you can do 70%, 70 to 80% of what you set up, that's still very high rate of success. So that's a lot right there. So first thing I challenge you is throughout my PowerPoint is to sit with your spine straight. The second thing that I challenge you is breathing. So if you look around and if you walk around, you'll realize that most people, they don't really breathe deep. So we don't, how often do you go? Very rare. Even if I walk, I don't really need to take a deep breath. I can walk and be a shallow breather. So once I start running, maybe then I stimulate the lungs. But with age and health conditions, and different stories, not everybody can run. Like my wife was joking today, she said, ha ha, when I see those people running, I say, that's not for me anymore because of the, we tried a few times, and the knee hurts. And, you know, so she said, I'm back to yoga. I'm going to start doing my yoga more intensely and forget this running, because she tried a few times. And it's not necessarily what works for every age, for every condition, for every body type. So I joke, I say, if you don't run after your food every day, or you don't run away from other villages, and you don't do cardiovascular four times a week, 40 minutes for over 4.5 on the treadmill, then you're a shallow breather. So the next thing you need to do is make a conscious decision. And eventually I have a joke, I say it's like the Rami parrot that say, breathe deep, breathe deep. And you have to make a conscious decision, and you have to say, I'm gonna start breathing deep. And then you just say, and you fill up the lungs, and you empty the lungs, and you keep doing it. And if you read Judah Folkman's theories of oxygen and all the food that we're looking for with anti-oxygen elements and stuff, this is a part, an element that is missing. Just taking deep breath and saturate your red blood system with oxygen by just taking those deep breaths over and over. But I tell you the truth, you're going to forget. You're going to say, wow, that sounds logical, that sounds good, I want to do it. But you're going to forget, like everybody else, including me. So I created tricks for myself, and you have to create those tricks for you. For example, when I wait for the email. So I say, okay, might as well. A few deep breaths before I start eating. Some people like, they do a prayer. I go, oh, wait. And I take a deep breath, and I say, okay, I'm trying to maintain while I'm eating. Waiting in the red light, and on, here and there. So you find those tricks. When do you breathe deep? And before you know it, you have those places, and it reminds you, and you start doing it yourself. So the deep breathing through the nose, in and out. And like you work the lungs like they're a bellow or like an accordion. Yeah, in and out. And that's just the beginning. There's a whole science to the breath in both qigong, tai chi, and in yoga. In all those philosophies, there's a whole science of breath, of practicing different postures of breath. Different areas of the lungs get filled up. You learn to put air into different parts of the lungs. And before you know it, you develop your lungs, and you have a much larger lung capacity and more oxygen flowing through your system. And that, if that doesn't convince you for health reasons, so at least if you want smoother skin, so breathing will lead to smoother skin, because the skin is a living, breathing organism. So the more you breathe, eventually it will reach all the way to the outer layers, to the skin. So two goals until I finish the PowerPoint presentation. One, keep your spine upright. Two, while I talk, keep working the lungs. Maybe in the beginning you'll do 5 seconds in and 5 seconds out. Maybe by the end of me talking you'll be able to do 8, 9, and 10 seconds in and 10 seconds out. So the breath grows bigger and bigger the more you do it, because the muscles around the lungs, very elastic. So the more you demand from them, they'll say, oh, I need to grow, I need to expand, and the bigger they expand. So it's just a matter of practice. And if you think about it, that's a big common principle within all the Eastern philosophies. So spine and the trunk and breathing deep. The third one is the mind, but we'll get into it when I we start. So you can see that the first thing that a lot of those philosophies are divided into is five building blocks. The body, the breath, the mind, the energy, and the spirit. All of those five building blocks need to be fine-tuned until fine-tuning is not needed. So what does that mean? It's like a guitar. You, at first it's not fine-tuned, and you take each string and you fine-tune it, and then it has the right sound, the right vibration, the right feeling. So for example, I'll just give you an example with the body. So the knee is designed to touch up here. But not many people can do that. So you start in my classes, people start here, and they go to here, and maybe 3 months later they go to here, and maybe 6 months later, they lean against the wall and they're able to bring their knee a little up here. Then we use the chair and it starts to help them. And before you know it, their knee can go to where it's designed to reach. And on, there's a lot of body markers, I call it, to start with on the body level that one needs to fine tune until fine tuning is not needed. So if you look from the bottom up, so the ankle has 42 degrees and a half, the quads 180, the hamstring 142, the trunk should turn 90, the same as the neck, and on, the rotator cuffs. So they should all, so we strive or fine tune to what the skeleton or the body was designed to really do. And that's a common, again, element in yoga, tai chi, and qigong, and a few other Eastern philosophies. The second building block is the breath. So the breath, as I mentioned before, first, you just start to work with what you have. If you ask a lot of people to breathe deep, let's do an experiment. Everybody, take a deep breath. Do it. You'll see if you look around the room, a lot of people do this. And it's called putting air into the upper front parts of the lungs. So not many people put air into the bottom parts of the lungs, into the middle, into the back, mid-back, upper back lungs. So not, and I can still talk with all this movement of air. So not a lot of people know how to utilize their lungs to their full potential. And why? Because we don't practice it. Who does know how to do it? Musicians, singers, people that do yoga, pranayama, all kind of very trendy or, you know, small percentage of population that have training with the lungs and they need to utilize the lung, then they do know and they do have exercises within each technique or each approach. And there's different ones, of course. But the yoga, the Tai Chi and Qigong have it down like a science from start to very, it's called skin breathing, all the way to sitting there and feeling the skin breathe with you. So it's called, and then eventually bone. So it's called bone skin breathing. So your mind, so breathing, you can see, moves beyond the physical. So it doesn't end on a physical level. After a certain point, it starts to become mental. So breathing from the lungs first, and then you add the mind. In Tai Chi, for example, when you do a move in Tai Chi, the reason it's been done so slow, this form of Tai Chi, is because while physically you move slow, your mind on the inhalation moves to the center, and on exhalation moves to the four extremes, the palms and the center of the feet. So it's called four gates breathing. When you inhale, you condense the spirit. When you exhale, you expand the spirit. So it's called spiritual breathing. So there's a lot of ways in the breath to go beyond just the physical. On the other hand, on a physical level, there's a seesaw breath. Let's try it. So what you do is you lift one side and you breathe into the right lung. Then you exhale from that side, and then you do, and you try to breathe into the left lung. So by collapsing or closing one side of your lung, you open the other parts of the lungs, the other side, the other lobes, and air flows strongly into that area. So it's called seesaw breath. Of course, you don't do it 2 times. You do it 3 minutes. Yeah, but today it's just a taste. You just get a taste of everything. You don't get a whole meal. Sorry. After that, you say, oh, I like those dishes. I want to go eat more of it. So then you have to go to the class, and you have to be consistent. And over time, you see the results, the differences. So breath and mind, you can see at a certain point, they become one. So eventually, what you do is, if you do an exercise like what I talked about, put the leg up here. So that's body. Then with the breath, you focus the breath. And then for beginners, the mind focuses on the breath, like Zen. It's called Zen mind. So they go. Of course, in my class, I prefer that people hold to something. So I don't want them to also deal with the balance when they do body, breath, and mind. So enough to do body here, not, and you don't want to add the balance. Over time, you can also add the balance when you close your eyes. So you can see in the body, there's another element which is balance that Tai Chi is very strong, emphasize strongly. So mind, body, and breath all become in one motion, one movement. The fourth category is energy. So the energy is the same energetic system that the acupuncture stick their needles, that shiatsu try to affect with the pressure points, that some of the herbal, Chinese herbal industry, they try to affect the energetic system, Reiki, therapeutic massage, all kind of different styles work with this energetic system. The energetic system, according to the Chinese at least, have 12 rivers, 8 big reservoirs, which are energy centers, and a lot of ways to activate the system to make it more cool, yin, to make it more warmer, yang, emotions, wisdom. So it talks about all those elements. And if you get my book, Sunrise or Sunset Tai Chi, you can find in chapter 2, it all talks about the energetic system. So the energy system is the fourth category. So for example, if I go back to that one exercise that I'm giving an example, the hip extension, or I call it the flamingo, because the flamingo, you'll see, will target the last building blocks, which is the spirit. So if I go to this, or body, my goal is to get this higher and higher. Breath, I work with my breath, make it deeper and deeper. The mind this time, because I'm adding the energetic system, visualize a healing energy ball 2 inches below the navel. So that's the first visualization that you practice when you practice visualization in Tai Chi or Qigong. So that's the fourth. So that will be four building block within one exercise. So this time the breath, my mind is monitoring the breath, but visualize a healing energy ball 2 inches below the navel. So that's called the lower energy center, or in Chinese, lower dantian. So that's four building blocks. And then the fifth one, which is very important, is while I'm standing there, I close my eyes, I monitor those four blocks, but at the same time, I need to evoke the spirit. So when I want to evoke the spirit, there's many ways to do it. Like one lady told me once, Rami, you know, you always tell us to evoke the spirit, but when I'm in the getting a transfusion, and I'm lying there, and it's all cold, and it was also in the 80s when there were metal tables, and I'm sure now it's much better. And she said, when I lie there, and these rooms are physical, what I see is the three angels coming around and holding their wings around me. I was like, wow, okay, that's much more powerful than what I'm visualizing. I just visualized the earth and the heaven and me like this, or maybe a bird. I said, what's the name? She gave me the name. Gabriel, Daniel, and I forget the third one. I was like, yeah. I said to her, wow, that's a much more powerful visualization than mine. Keep at it. So it doesn't matter to me what you visualize spiritually, but just by closing your eyes, and for me, I work with the nature spirit, so I'm staying neutral. Doesn't matter to me, religion and all this stuff. So I just visualize the earth, my energy center, and the heaven. It's called three forces unification. Heaven, human, and earth. So that evoke, actually, there's studies showing that evoke certain parts of the brain, which is related to spiritual, which later is part of leading into positive hormone production from the pituitary gland and all this and that. So in general, a good style or a good teacher will emphasize those five building blocks with any motion, any movement, anything you do. It does not mean it happens right away. And some traditionally can happen over a 20 years period. Modernly, it can happen in the first class. It just depends on who teaches it and what's the style. So a lot of time I say, be careful. It's not the style necessary that is good or not good for you. It's who teaching the style. I know a lot of people, they went to classes of yoga or Tai Chi or Qigong and say, it's not for me. That's not true. You just didn't enter the style from the road or path that you're supposed to enter or come from. And that's sometimes it's the teacher's job to find out where are you at, what do you need next, and what will keep you moving forward in that journey or path into yourself. So it's a journey into the self. But once we work on regulating or fine-tuning, then we try to find balance between the five. So we need to find balance, and then we try to harmonize it. So if you compare it to an orchestra, first each person goes and trains their own instruments. Then they come and in a group and they try to balance it. And after they balance it, they reach a harmony. So they reach a harmonization. So that's part of the journey. And that takes time. Each person, it's different length, and it takes time. But don't forget that this is just part of the formula of better health, prevention, and having what I consider a box of mind-body tools that empowers individuals to take an active role in their journey. So it's a part of the formula. The other ones, we all know it, and that's why we're looking for those. Of course, the air we breathe is very important. The planet, the forces, the moon, the sun, the exposure to all those elements. People around us, very important. It's a lot of interaction, a lot of effect, a lot of outcomes, and both positive and negative. So you have to choose and pick and be smart about it. And then food, of course, nutrition, which is a lot more popular and accepted in every institute you go, every hospital, throughout the whole society, including high school, you see it now and everywhere. So the nutrition and all those other elements are another part of you seeking better health. But I say it's beyond better health. It's better quality of life because you do all those things. But it's also prevention. You know, you're investing in prevention. So, and it's not to say something can happen, but at least you know you did your part the best you could. So, as you can see, there's more than one Eastern art. And they're all good, as I said. It's not all about the art. It's about who's teaching it a lot of time. There's a saying, you can master one of those arts in 10 is in the old days, let's say 20 years. But it can take you 30 to 40 years to find the right teacher. So it takes much longer to find the right teacher than to master it. And then a lot of them have this triangle of body, mind, and spirit. The qigong and the tai chi, the energetic block is much more emphasized, much more, there's a stronger emphasis in it than in other styles. But you can see qigong and tai chi, kung fu, yoga, meditation, they're all philosophies that exist within one another, and also are separate from one another. So there's niches and branches and on and on. So this is just an example. Some people are confused between tai chi and qigong. Who knows the difference between tai chi and qigong? So qigong is the science of all energy. So qigong is the science of all energy. For example, there's four schools of thoughts of qigong. So there's scholar qigong, or Confucius, like Lao Tzu, and other Confucius like this. Their goal was to increase the energy to the brain and make the brain smarter and more the ability to be a deeper and smarter philosopher. So their goal was, let's make that energy the strongest. Versus martial qigong is people said, you know, for me, the smarter is not as important. For me, it's to fight and to protect my village and to protect my country and to make an army. So those kind of people, they learn how to direct this energy or build that energy towards fighting and being a warrior. Versus medical qigong was like, well, I don't need to fight and I'm not into the philosophy, but I need to be healthier and stronger. And then so the martial element is removed and then the focus is on health. It's not to say that to be a martial qigong, you probably would cover a lot of the medical qigong. As my teacher told me, oh, you want to learn how to fight? I said, yeah, I want to be able to, not to fight one person, I want to be able to control the situation if five people attack me, you know, and not just one. I want to be able, like, to control this and not to get hurt and not to hurt them, but they'll recognize the fact that I won. So he said, well, and I can do that, by the way. He said, well, if you want to learn how to kill, I have to first teach you how to heal. If you know how to heal, you'll understand the joints, the ligaments, the tendons, the bones, the organs, where they are, what's the angle, how do you reach them? And in the Chinese learning, it's not theory. You don't learn. It's called hands-on. When they talk about the liver, you push your hand, you feel the liver. You talk about the kidneys, it's called hands-on. You literally recognize where the kidneys, and you go and you work with different organs and different times and with different exercises. So as you can see, I line it up in such a way that one leads to the other in some way. There's a connection. And then the last school of thought, it's called religious qigong. They're the most, they do all of it. They do all, probably all three. So those are the monks in the mountains, and they want to reach another goal. Their goal is to get out of reincarnation. They believe that when you die, your energy goes to other humans, and if they work strong enough, they'll be able to be an independent entity or an angel or whatever we want to call it. So for me, I focused mostly on the medical and martial qigong. And I read about the other ones, but for me, the main focus throughout my career was those two. So this is the different. And then another one more sentence, they say qigong is tai chi, but tai chi is not necessarily qigong. Because qigong includes tai chi in it. So martial qigong is tai chi, and health qigong is tai chi. So that's why I like the tai chi. But so you can see that qigong is tai chi, but tai chi is not necessarily qigong, only a piece of qigong. It's only a two of the school thoughts out of the four. Okay. Let's see. So this is what I talked in general about each block. What are the goals? You can look at it quickly. Like I said, the body is to reach the potential of our body. One of the sentences that is used by me and other schools, like it's the first thing on the body level, you want to free your skeleton from being a prisoner of the soft tissue. So the reason a lot of those things, that the angles that I talked about in the body, people cannot do them, is because with age and time and lifestyle, the soft tissue shrinks on top of our skeleton. And then the next thing, your skeleton is restricted. Now, it's not always your fault. You know, you do surgery, you do treatment. So there's other elements come into play. You break something, you tear something. I mean, there's other elements that come into play. So all of those, and including, I say, modernization, like all those computer and sitting in the car, and so, you know, all, and sofas that you just sink into them, and beds that they show how, even they have advertising that it's, he sleeps so well with this, some arch like that, and on and on. So all that leads to this shrinkage of the soft tissue. When we say soft tissue, it's skin, fascia, muscles, tendons, and ligaments. So all of that shrink, and the next thing you know, your skeleton is restricted and it cannot do what it was designed to do in the first place. And we accept it for what it is, and there's no reason to accept it. What you need just to do is to have a regular routine that goes from the bottom up, and every day you emphasize a few of them, and you just maintain what you designed to do, but easier said than done. So, you know. Yeah. And then the mind, very, very nice. I love this metaphor in the mind. In the mind in qigong and tai chi, they talk about two minds. The monkey mind and the horse mind. The monkey mind is your emotions. The horse mind is your wisdom. You don't want to get rid of either one. If you get rid of the monkey, you'll be like Data from, you'll be a robot. So you want to have emotions. You want to have the monkey as the kids. I have four kids, two little ones. We call them the little ones. That's 11 and 9. And then we have the big ones, 16 and 17. So the little ones, they're still like the monkey, you know. They're like still so cute, so innocent. Like, what did he say the other day? What, it's Friday today? Like, yeah. I thought it was Tuesday or something like that. You know, and on like that. So they live in their little world, emotional, and they're cute, and they're warm, and this and that. So we have the monkey, and we have the horse, the wisdom. You say, tomorrow morning, I need to get up and start exercising. I'm going to wake up earlier than I'm used to. I wake up at 7:30, I'll wake up at 6. Wow, that's your wisdom. 6 o'clock come, the alarm goes on, you push the monkey button, the snooze. Say, I'll do it tomorrow, not today. So all the time we have this battle between, I'm thinking of chocolate now and ice cream, between the monkey and the emotion. So in the qigong, they say you have to give the monkey a banana. So you have to seize the monkey, not kill, not seize, just seize and train the horse. Mm-hmm. Capture the monkey and train the horse. And that means that you train to control the emotions, but at the same time, you let them be when you need them to be. And you train the wisdom to be more over time, the decision making, and on and on. So eventually they say you have to give a banana to the monkey, because if you tell the monkey, do it, the monkey is going to go like you. It's hard to tell. So you have to kind of, like I said, remember I said, tricking yourself by creating situation that you breathe deep. You have to offer the monkey a banana. The banana, the first banana in training is the breath. So that's why I want you to develop your lungs. So when you need to quiet the mind, the emotions, you just go. You just take three deep breaths. And that already calms the mind. Calms the emotions. If the emotions are really startled, sometimes a friend. You go with a good friend and you go around a lake or something, walking and talking, and it sees the monkey. So there's a lot of tricks, a banana that you need to offer, that you can offer to the monkey. If you want to know more about it, read this book, this children book, Caps for Sale. You know that book?
Yeah.
So you'll see there a little bit of what I'm talking about. So you can see when it comes to the breath, the spirit, as I mentioned before, you can raise the spirit and you need to learn to cool the spirit. So the spirit needs to be, if people's spirit is too raised, they're too intense, it's too much, it's too fire. So it needs to be balanced within the spirit as well. And on an energy level, you want to learn the energetic system. You want to learn how to strengthen that system. And you want to learn how to cool and heat. It's called kan and li, fire and water. So you want to learn the tricks of what makes the energy more yin or what makes the energy more yang. Some people come and they're very young, so they need to be yin. Some people are very yin, they need to be yang. So you always want to strive for balance, and that takes some knowledge and then eventually practice. I won't go on into the studies, but there was a few studies here we did with qigong and cortisol but in general, the best result we achieved here was with anxiety, depression, but that was a long time ago, and it was just a very basic. So this is the emperor-empress position. Again, you see, I give it names that have a spirit in it. You know, imagine you're an emperor, an empress, and you try to rule your kingdom like this. So this also is much more authority, much more, why? Because it's a stronger spirit. So when you have a stronger spirit, you have more also command on the people around you, I hope. Depending how you do, what you do, other things. This is the first lower energy center, as I mentioned, that individual start to practice. So I want you to experiment with it for a second. So I want you to sit straight and close your eyes and try to visualize a healing energy ball 2 inches below the navel in the center of the body. If your thoughts are still in your mind away from the visualization, don't worry about it, just loop it. Loop it back into the visualization. Very good. And then I want you now to do the same thing, try to empty your mind, but this time instead of using the visualization, use the breath. So close your eyes and breathe and use the breath to empty your mind. So anytime a thought's coming to your brain, just lead it into the breath. Okay, and then slowly bring your mind back. So I'm just for curiosity, since we're in a scientific place, how many people feel, and that was a quick experiment, how many people feel that when you visualize, you can quiet the mind stronger than when you use the breath? And how many people that felt that when they use the breath, they can quiet the mind stronger than the visualization? So how many feel the visualization is stronger for them to quiet the mind? Interesting, good. And then how many feel the breath? Yeah, I would say it's about 60-40 or 50-50. It was interesting. So you can see some people, it's the visualization that helps them. Some people is literally the breath and on and on. So if you go again into seawellness.com, it's the startup I started. It's free for all. If you go there and go to mind-body meditation, I give the introduction to what is meditation, how meditation is, which thing should fit you, so you can experiment. So there's, for example, the first meditation is you look at objects. So your eyes are open, you're looking at something. Another one, maybe you're the type that will close their eyes and listen to sounds, music, whatever, waves or classical or whatever. So some people, oh yeah, that's for me. Perfect. Then another one is some people, they focus on counting numbers. One in their head. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, like that. Another person said, oh, I just need the breath. Some other people said, I can do the visualization right now and be in it for 30 minutes and achieve this, more and more of this space. So as you can see, from external objects to chanting, to prayer, to silence, total silence, it gets harder and harder, because eventually you sit in a cave or in a room with no sound and you put 30-40 minutes and you just use your breath or you just use the visualization, that becomes very challenging, because a lot of people, it's hard for them when it's really quiet and not a sound, and now you have to sit with yourself and focus. So once you get to the breath and the visualization, it's more, I call it monastery style, more deep, 1 second. And then once you do more chanting, external means, and other meanings, it's more for me, more external. So you go deeper into internal and deeper external. It's not to say some days you can do that, some days you can do that. Yes. 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 Yeah, big role. Yeah. So there are different people. If I ask, you'll see some people see in different colors. Not only that, women see better the colors than the men. So if I have a room of men, they'll say, what colors? What energy ball? Like, what? Right, women are more, and it's the yin yang in our body. So because women are more yin and men are more yang, they're more closer to their energetic system, so they can able to sense it more. So what do you think women intuition is? It's this ability to sense the energy and feel around better than the guy that just doesn't as much. It's not to say, my theory is that with each gender, there's plus and minus, yin yang, and some men are on their line are more yang than some women that are more yin. So in some ways there's a parallelation and correlation. So it gets a little more sophisticated because of the yin yang. But in general, yes, different people will see different colors. Different colors mean different things. And so there's a whole science to that as well, yeah. But that's when you go into the energetic system, when I said, so you learn more and more and more about that block, and then you become more and more familiar with it. So, yeah. But But the next thing in the energetic system, for example, and that one I like to teach because it's very useful for people in Dana-Farber and people that in Western world society, kind of, I feel, it's called the bubble visualization. The bubble visualization is almost like you put a shield around you that protects you from negative forces coming at you. And that happens a lot when you go through diagnosis and treatment. Certain people really become annoying near you, and you need, but sometimes you're stuck with them or in an area with them, and you need to kind of shield them off. And you can't physically because you're with them, so you do the bubble visualization. So let's try that for a second. So what I want you to do is this. We're going to sit straight again, close your eyes, and this time instead of thinking in your body, think that there's a cocoon or a bubble about 2-3 inches away from your body. And you'll find out that some areas of the cocoon, they're not as strong as others. So what I want you to do is like take a spacula, or your mind is like, and spread the strength around it so you'll have an even strength of visualization around you. Like the floor is a stronger feeling because it's real. If you can have all around you this strong, maybe like fog or myth or bob, whatever you want to visualize or that is around you, or an energy field. And then so close your eyes and try to move out of your body about 2-3 inches away from your skin and create a nice cocoon all around you. Very good. Then bring your mind back. So this is called the bubble visualization, or in Chinese it's called the guardian qi. So it's an energy that guards you from the external forces, negative forces, energies, but it also a strainer that allows negative forces to leave your body. So in both the qigong and tai chi, when it comes to utilizing it towards healing, there's an exercise that I would like you now to do with me, and you sit again straight, and what we're going to do is going to scan the body from the top up with your mind. And then you're going to find along the scan areas or places where you store negative, you store energy, or there's a storage of energy, or they call it impurities. So for example, if I'll scan my body, so as soon as I reach here, I feel my eye bags. So this is genetic, by the way. My mom has it too. So I feel this. So if the plateau goes all the way from here to here, I feel it on the surface of the plateau. So it's not all the way in. It's just on the surface. Okay. Then I keep going down. I feel a little bit here because I've been talking now for almost 40 minutes. So I feel a little dryness here. Again, so if the plateau goes from here to here, it's on the surface of the inner part of the plateau, and it goes down maybe a few plateaus if I divide the plateaus into really thin ones. Then I keep going down. So I myself, I know this is there. So I have medical issues that I started doing Tai Chi and Qigong since I was 15 years old, and it's around the stomach intestine here. So if I go up, so I feel here, and this goes from here to here. So for me, it go through, let's say, 3 plateaus. Then I keep going down. My left knee is a little sore. I did a few things the last couple of days. I know it's a little sore here. I keep going down. The left sole of my feet has a little soreness there. So if I scan my body, those are my 5 spots. Okay, so I want you now, as an exercise, you scan your own body with your mind, and you tell me, where are your 5 impurities? Of course, I can find another 5 easily, but I just focused on the 5 that I noticed right away when I scan. So scan, and I'll ask if you're willing to tell me where's your 5 impurities. And so that's the first thing we need to determine.
where are those? And they say there's a list. What is impurities? Something that hurts, something that numbness, a tingling sound, feeling, something you know is there, like in my case, this thing, I know it's there, and on and on. So those, there's a long list, what are impurities? So scan and come out with your five impurities. Okay, good, and it's a quick scan here. So, anybody willing to share five spots that they scan and found? If you do, raise your hand so I'll know if you're willing to share. Sure.
Across the back of my neck and shoulders.
Yeah.
So, lots of tension there. Right in the edge of the sarcomere.
Yeah.
Really just for my knees.
Yeah. Exactly. Anybody else? Yes.
Here, side of my face.
Okay.
This part of my arm.
Okay.
Right in my midriff, like lower abdomen, my knee and my foot.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so each one of you, you'll find out that you scan and then you feel those impurities. Mm-hmm. So that's the first task. For you to scan, and you sit there for a few times, and you scan, and you say, oh, there's this. And you don't even have to explain to yourself why. In qigong, they say, it doesn't matter what it is. Like, let's say you have mud on your body, and in the mud is a piece of glass. And so what do you care what that glass is from? So the next goal you're going to do is, now I want you to close your eyes and go to one of those impurities. For example, so if I scan, I'm not going to waste energy and time on my eye bags. I don't care about them. I don't care about this. I can solve this later with a little water. And I don't care about my knee at this point because it's just, I know I can solve that later too. And my ankle is not the big problem. But for me, I'll focus now on this area. So I'll scan from the top down with my mind. I'll go right into here. So if this is the, if this is the feeling, let's say I feel, so I won't even go right into the center of it. I'll start dissolving, and the idea is to dissolve from the periphery. I'll start dissolving from the edges here. And I'll start dissolve from the edge and from the edge. So whatever you stumble into those sensations, treat it as solid, like a solid something. It's a solid feeling. That's your first sensation, it's solid. And then with your mind, you're going to go eyes to water, water to gas. So you're going to try to change the impurity from solid to liquid, from liquid to gas. Yeah? Eyes to water, water to gas. I tell you the truth, many days, I don't even try to go to gas. I just say eyes to water. If I could just change it to water, it's already, I can, so I'm going to give you a minute or two. Again, like I said, it's a quick, that was scanning seminar. So, and then start. So scan, choose one impurity that is the most important to you, and scan it with your mind. Eyes to water, water to gas. Okay, then bring your mind back. Again, sorry, it's all quick. You hear that sound, beep, beep. That's the impurities taking, reversing away from your body. How many of you experienced that they can actually feel change from solid to slightly liquid? Yeah. So it takes time. And what I call it, they may call it this, I call it the power of the mind. We don't really know what is the power of our mind. Mm-hmm. So as my mom used to tell me, Rami, if it doesn't hurt, try it. You know? So there's a lot of this power of the mind. I also call this chemotherapy the Eastern way. So you use your mind and you go where you know the stuff and you dissolve those areas. And you can do work the bones, you can work different parts of your body. So that's a very powerful meditation that I use and I teach. And of course, we did it 2-3 minutes. But it's a good start, mm-hmm. to experiment with it. But eventually you want to sit there. There's a saying, they say only after 20 minutes things really start in meditations. And I also say a good teacher will teach you not only sitting meditation, but sitting, standing. There's a lot of standing postures, there's different styles. There's different postures of meditation that you stand. And moving. So moving is the Tai Chi. So even that you move, you're still in a meditative mindset. And if you want to know what is meditation, quickly, it's just controlling your brain waves. So when you focus on a math problem, you're in alpha. When you're on the beach and you're talking, oh, how are you doing? Oh, but you're changing subjects, you're in beta. Your mind is very busy in both brain waves. Mm-hmm. When you sleep, you're still thinking, dreaming. There's only two stages of sleep, which are deep. It's 3 and 4. Again, this is different than seewellness.com. If you go to my website, myname.com, ramelrones.com, I blog every week. And again, it's free. I blog every week. You get 1 3-minute video or about things that I have passion about. I'm lucky today. Matthew is here, and Matthew has been doing it now for how long? Have we been doing it? 2 years?
Close to 3, I think.
3 years. If it wasn't for him, I wouldn't have done it. And he's my Tufts junior college graduate that I put in a note in the newspaper, and he answered it. And he's passionate about all this. And he's the one really helped me with all the digital, with editing, with correct. He changes my Ibnish to English. And a lot of the blog is really happening thanks to Matthew, and he's following the tweeters and the weepers and the peepers and all that. So you see, it's yin and yang, old and young technology. So if you go there, you'll see the blog. If you Google in the blog, sleep, what was it, under sleep?
Brainwaves.
Brainwave sleep. You see a beautiful diagram of the 5 stages of sleep. 2 of them is that meditative, between awakening and sleep, that you go very deep. That's why some days you wake up and you say, oh, I feel so tired. Like I was in bed, but I don't feel like I slept, because you didn't hit those deep levels of sleep. But that's why meditation is so important. So you can say, you know what, I didn't get a good night's sleep, so I'll do 10 minutes here. And you go right between awake and asleep, using whatever tricks you need, as I said, if it's an external, music, visualization, whatever it takes. And you hit this place between awake and asleep, and it's like a power nap, a boost. Sometimes you're too tired, just lie on your back and fall asleep for 10, 15 minutes. It's another boost. But that's not, lying on the floor is not a meditation. I call it a relaxation. And there's a lot of work lying on your back and lying in different posture, but that's different than the meditation. What else? Let's see, because I probably have a minute or two now. Any question, I guess? Let's answer some questions. Yes?
Do you have any suggestions on how to find a good instructor? Where to look for them?
Come to my classes first.
I can't. I'm in New York.
Read my blog and my books.
Okay.
And then you'll get like a sense of the knowledge, and then you'll start looking for it. And what we'll do now is I'll tackle it. I'll say, so we'll try to tackle it maybe. No, we have a plan for the next 4 or 5 blogs. But maybe one of the blogs will be how to find a good teacher. That's a great question. If you email it to me, we'll bank it, and I think I can tackle something like that. I have to think about it. It's not easy, because I have people calling me and say, Rami, I'm in Israel, for example, or I'm in Paris. What should I do? Find a good teacher. I say, you know what? Go swimming. I said, go swimming. Swim 4 times a week. Make it the same time. After 3 months, either increase the range of swimming or increase the time of swimming. So at least in the water, I'm sure it's going to be as close to Tai Chi. The systematic benchmark will allow to progress. There's resistance, flexibility there. There's lungs there. The next thing I tell them, make sure you mouthwash with Listerine every time you come out of the pool. Because there's so much bacteria in the pools. So it's really important to come out and really mouthwash Listerine. I hate to advertise Listerine. I grew up, my mother is a virologist. So we grew up with a big salt near the sink. And we put salt and go, never get sick, always stronger than most. Is it genetic? Is it because of the salt? I don't know. Luckily, the Listerine was invented. First, when I came in the 80s, it was horrible taste. So I kept using the salt and water. And then eventually, they made the mint and this and that. Again, I hate to advertise them, but I swear by it, and I teach it to all my students. I have a Listerine in my car. I have it in the bedroom. I have it in the bathrooms. I have a, because you, again, you forget. You say, oh, I ate now, and I'm in my car. I wish I have a bottle. I just, and I say, take it, put it in your mouth, do 2 minutes, walk away, because 2 minutes you stay in the bathroom, it's too little. So you walk away. Then deep throat, gargling, spit it out. You can also do it, I know here it's a problem sometimes with alcohol, so you do it with salt water if possible. Mm-hmm. So that's also part of it. So I'll try to tackle it, but it is a hard one. It is a hard one. Sometimes you're just lucky. Like I was always fell on the right teachers, but it's not just luck. I mean, I took a suitcase. I was 21 years old and $1,200, and I said, I'm going to go fly to Boston from Israel to study with this Chinese teacher that I read one of his books, and I realized. So some of it was my wisdom, my thinking, and then I was lucky that when I met him, he was unknown, and the next thing, he was one of the most known qigong masters in the world. The same with my yoga teacher. I studied with, I don't know how you know, Patricia Walden. When I met her, she only had a little studio in Somerville in the 80s. And the next thing, she becomes the talking of the whole world of yoga. And she's on the yoga books, and you know, she's amazing. So I was lucky. And some of it maybe is because I'm so enthusiastic and I want to learn. And they see it, and I'm like, oh, that's a good one. Come here, I'll teach you. Because it takes so much to teach that you need those people that really want to learn and are willing, because you have so much to pass down to them. So a little bit, after a while when you teach, you get tired of it. There's a whole element of teaching that I analyze in my books, I think. How do you teach when you're in your 20s? How do you teach when you're in your 30s? And how do you teach when you're in your 50s and 60s? And I got to tell you the truth, the older you are, different emphasis or different strength those teachers have. So when you're with a younger teacher, it's more physical. But you need that as well if you want to know the art. And it's older per age, in 60s and up, it's more spiritual. And in the mid-40s, it's breath and then mindfulness. So the progression of the 5 building blocks also follows teacher's career pretty much if you analyze it. So sometimes you come to the teacher, but you actually want to learn from his top young student. And then the teacher too. So you get that balance between the body block and the spiritual or the mind block. So it is, that's a very hard question to answer.
Thank you. So is your book downstairs in Friend's Place?
I left it a few times. Every time I leave it, whoever takes it doesn't return it. They love the book, I guess. It's a compliment to me.
No,
but you can
buy.
Barter it. I made it really cheap. Okay. I made one's $15.99, $16.99, the other one $19.99. One is 200 pages, one is 450 pages or 420. And So I say it's $40 for the both in Amazon. So and you can look. And sometimes they have deals. I heard people can buy it cheaper than I can buy it. So Sunrise and Sunset Tai Chi. Those are the two books.
Okay.
And I'll bring some more downstairs. I was meaning to do it anyhow. to the resource center down there.
Right.
They should have the DVDs there, maybe.
Oh, okay.
Because that one, they think they don't let people borrow it. I'm not sure how it works, so I'll bring that. And then if you can, sign up for my blog, RommelRoanes.com. And if you're interested in nutrition videos, mind-body videos, that's the cwellness.com. So cwellness, I'm not the only partner there. I have an input. They let me input my ideas, my videos, but I also, my job is to identify other people that I think are really strong contributor to cancer.
Mm-hmm.
So cancer wellness, cwellness. So if I hear of a good nutritionist, like I know a few here in the Zekem Center, I ask them, can I shoot you please? Can I give your knowledge? And it's free. So if they're willing, I do it. So I'm up to, I think, 120 videos, 3 minutes each, about 25 in nutrition, maybe 40, 50 in mind, body, yoga, and on and on. So my idea is to create an information center for cancer survivors, patients, caretaker, people, the caregivers, families, that they can just go there and find out different things to do for themselves as well as others. So that's the main idea.
Is
yes.
It the letter C or S E E or
C? The letter C, wellness.com.
No,
C. I don't know.
The letter C?
No, that's why I said C for cancer. Yeah, C, the letter C, wellness.com.
Okay, I'm going to change that.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you.
My classes are here. If you're interested, I'm teaching here on Tuesdays from 3 to 6, two classes, an hour and a half each. You can come to both or half or whatever. And the other one on Fridays from 10 to 1 here in the Smith 330. When you go back, you'll see it on your left, Smith 330.